As the lady said, you're in the session The Strength of Power Shell on One Line. I'm Jeff Wouters. I'm a freelance technical consultant and architect with the main focus on system center, automation, but especially PowerShell. Because anything you can't do in a GUI, you can you still use PowerShell. Well, the agenda, a little bit about me. Then we'll start the demo. And we'll do it until the time is over and we've got about 10 minutes time left for questions. Well, like I said, Jeff Wouters, my company is called Mythos IT, born in 1985, Netherlands. And I recently started the Dutch PowerShell user group, dubsoc.com. And if you're on social media, just search for Jeff Wouters and you'll find me. Google Plus, Facebook, LinkedIn. Talk harder? Okay. And that's basically, with the exception of the question slide, that's all the slides I have. The rest will be demo. So, the strength of PowerShell. Who here has never used PowerShell before? Very happy to... One finger, okay. Have you ever heard of PowerShell of what it, or what it can do? Okay. In that case, I heard there were a lot of PowerShell 101 sessions at these events, so I'm gonna skip that one. But basically, PowerShell is all about piping for one-liners. You can use get process, stop process. This will give me some errors, and I won't do it because I will have a system failure. But for example, if you have protected system services, it will provide an error. And you can use a parameter called force. That's like no questions asked, just do it. That's one of the strengths of PowerShell. It's very, very powerful, but also very dangerous. Because if an intern gets a prompt and he gets admin rights, he can take your entire environment down with one line. I'll show that at the end, by the way. So for this, all the dangerous commands got a what if parameter. Now it doesn't do the actual job, it will tell you what it should do, what it will do, if you remove the what if. As you can see, I'm running Windows 8 with Hyper-V. So what I basically want to do is start up my environment. I've got two virtual machines running already. Now I want to start the rest. So normally I would do get virtual machine. That's for getting the virtual machines, not starting them yet. But when I do this, I don't get any feedback. That's the thing I found in Windows 8. You have to start the PowerShell command prompt as an administrator. Now I'm getting virtual machines. So if I know the virtual machines, and as you can see, they're booting up. You can even configure the delay time for a virtual machine to start. So if you got that right for your entire environment, with one command, you can boot up your entire demo environment without using a GUI. What I use it for with customers is I log on to a management workstation at home on one of my VDI environments. And with one command, I start my demo environment, wait for about, 60 seconds, and I'm done. I can use anything remotely. And I'll show you a little thing I found out last night when I made some last minute changes to my demo. And I know it's not recommended, but I love to do it. PowerShell remoting. Has anyone ever used it? Okay, PowerShell remoting can give you something like an SSH session towards a server. And so you're basically working on that server. Anything you put in, it will be executed entirely on that device. So you can start a remote PowerShell session not only to one device, but to many devices at the same time. So in that case, you will enter those sessions, give one command, and it will be executed on one or 1,000 devices at the same time. Especially useful because in the Netherlands there was a website nu.nl, I believe, that was hacked, and there was a little bit of spam in there. So all our workstations were infected by it. So we very quickly found out what DOL, what file is written. And with one command, you can scan your entire environment for the devices that have that file name. And next, remove the file if you want to. But we've chosen for the solution to start a remote session, look for the file, and if the file is found, disable the network adapter. And a user doesn't have the rights to enable it again, so they'll call the help desk. It's not an antivirus solution, by the way, but it can help you to quickly identify the problems. Okay, what I found out last evening was when you do new PS session, by the way, for the ones who don't know that, with tab, you can complete the command and the parameter, and recently with PowerShell version 3, also the variables, if you've defined them before. It makes typing on the prompt a lot faster. Well, the computer name, and I've named my domain controller DC. Sounds logical, right? So I start a new PowerShell session. Error. Why is this? Well, let's go to the domain controller. If it doesn't work one way, it shouldn't work the other way. Right? I've done something with my resolution. Well, Brian was using the projector I got right here. It's a very luxurious projector. So I didn't have time to set this up correctly. But it's still a very good picture. Okay, let's do the same, but the other way around. And now it will work. So that's something I found out. Don't name your domain controller DC. DC01 works fine. I tested it at home. But DC, no. So next, we'll enter the PowerShell session. When I do this, it will ask for a computer name. So, clear screen. Enter PS session, computer name, management. And as you can see on the left, it will have included management in there. Now, as I said, you can either connect to one or to many. And those many will be in the command line where now management is shown. So it will shorten it, else it will become with 1,000 devices, it will become so big it won't be readable anymore. Right now, these are the processes that are running on my management server. So what I want to do now is get process, stop process, and stop yammering, just do it. So I'll open it here. I'll switch between them very quickly. 3, 2, 1. And as you can see, oh, it should have been gone. It's still. Here we are, blue screen. And as I said, this is a remote session. What you can also do is invoke command. Parameter is the computer name, or many computers again. Put it into brackets. And the same way, the command will be pushed towards that computer. Instead of it will push towards a session and then execute it. Invoke command is very useful when you do just a single command. Like the name says, invoke command. But if you do more commands after each other, and they are dependent on each other, for example, then the best practice is to use PS sessions. So if I know, as a consultant, I come to a lot of companies that have different environments and different qualities of environments. For example, the application Active Directory replication may not work or may not work correctly. Or they are using dynamic VHD files in the production environment. It's not very well advised in 2008 or R2. So I've asked my customer if I was allowed to connect to their environment. And as this is still basically a Citrix event, I'm using Citrix. Download. I thought that I had this set up before, but apparently I haven't. Oh, skip to logon. Good morning. And that's when I notice I've got way too much stuff on my computer. Well, this will take some time. What issues do you have when you go to a customer? Do you want to inventory their virtual machine environment or SCCM environment, the entire environment itself? What are the challenges you're encountering? Anyone? Yeah. Okay, you could use PowerShell for it, but PowerShell doesn't do anything with GUIs. So you will require an automated installation with just parameters, and that's it. If you don't have that, you've got a challenge.
Right, so a lot of the stuff you can use command line switches to set certain things, like Epic, the healthcare, medical records application. A lot of times there are support updates for that, so you can install it.
But yeah.
Just command line switches.
But I had one customer that was having that exact issue. They were having 200 workstations and laptops, and they didn't have a software deployment method. Yes, it was basically CD, you put it in there and you install the stuff. But that wasn't the way to go. So they asked me to write a bunch of PowerShell scripts for that, and I did a simple calculation. The time it would take me to write them and package the applications, or buy MDT or SCCM and deploy it like that. And they were a lot cheaper just buying instead of hiring me. Next to that, they didn't have any PowerShell knowledge internally, so either the system administrator will have to learn it, and he didn't want to, or buy a tool that he can click. So So it's a choice. Yep. And I'm being blunt again. Where have I saved it? I think I know why. If I'm right, that won't work. There we go. And with any luck, we're getting there. So basically, my customer is currently implementing the entire System Center suite. So from AppLocker of AppController to SCUM to System Center, Virtual Machine Manager, anything. And it's a fun project. Next up is upgrading the operating system to 2012, if that's possible. And yes, they have legacy applications, a few. And this is a little bit of history. This customer has secured their environment that well, that as a system administrator remotely, and you want to do stuff, you will have to find a way around the security. Yep. Okay, I've got here a DPM server. And a PowerShell prompt. With Microsoft, back in 2009, they said that every single product group had to support PowerShell. The Exchange guys were embracing it. Some of the other products, not so much, but most of them followed. And so every bigger Microsoft product has PowerShell support and PowerShell CMD lids. So for example, if Exchange starts, you will get a tip of the day. Just a simple tip to help you learn PowerShell. And DPM gives you this. Some basic tips that if you want to get all the CMD lids, you use get command. But if you want only the DPM commands, get DPM command. Normally you could filter for a module, but DPM not that like that. So get group protection group, because DPM has a protection groups. When I do this, it asks me for a DPM server. So, server could not be found. This was a pop-up in a few minutes with the protection groups. But something I found out with some Microsoft products and PowerShell, they won't support the local host name. You have to fill in the proper name like DNS or NetBIOS. This is going to take a minute. If I'm right, this week the customer is putting all their devices into DPM for backup. And it's about 500 servers, so it's probably a little busy. But this will give the protection groups. But when I've got the protection groups, normally what I want is get all the tapes. because those are the ones that I got my hands on. And with one of my customers, the government came along because of an investigation, and they asked us to provide all the backup tapes and the backup tapes information, like from DPM, for example, what data is stored on what tape. And DPM doesn't do that reporting itself, so I had to write a PowerShell script. That wasn't the one-liner, by the way, it was a little bit bigger. So now you've got all the tapes. Well, when I know the tape, you saw I had a lot of information, so I only want to select one. Now, let's say, for example, I want a label. This will give an output with all the labels. But as they told me, they didn't want the labels, they wanted the barcode. And I hope I made a typo. Here we go. You can also combine them. So, wake up. Barcode, comma, label. This is a simple way with a bunch of one-liners. You can go provide a lot of reports to your manager, to the IRS, for example. When I go to a customer and I want to inventory their environment, this is the way I do it. Simple PowerShell. You can use SCUM for it, but then you will have to create a database, create a SCUM server, install the clients, install the management packs. This takes me about, well, maybe 1 hour. How long does it take you to install SCUM in an unknown environment? Well, let's go a little bit back to the domain controller. Most of the times, what I want to know is very simple, the domain name. Let's start with that. Again, PowerShell can help you with it a lot. This is a little bit more advanced. This is not a simple cmdlib like get command, get help. This is basically assembly code you can put into the PowerShell line. So what I know now is some of the properties it provides. Well, after some Googling or creative searching, you will notice that get current domain is one of the options. The get current domain isn't a property, it's a method. So with every method at the end, you put this. I've got my domain information. So I also know the domain mode. Let's say, for example, you've got a 2012 domain and you're still using one 2003 domain controller. Your native level will be 2003. And let's say a customer is wondering why their Active Directory recycle bin isn't working. Maybe that's why. Well, get current domain is one. Two. explain this one in a few seconds if I'm getting the syntax right. I believe it was, yeah, this one. Right now, I've got the domain controller names. As you can see, I'm using one read-only domain controller. What I did last night was delete the read-only domain controller, with the simple reason you can also find the active domain controllers, like this. Then you will need to scan the Active Directory and find them. But with this, you can easily identify which domain controllers are causing the problem, or better, which domain controllers aren't there anymore and therefore causing the problem. Well, let's start with the computers. Get AD computer. It will require a filter. So let's filter on everything. I've got all my computers. Okay. What I'll do right now is, yes, I want to find all the computers, but I want to find old computers, like they've been installed, made a member of the domain, and they got broken or reinstalled with another name. Then the Active Directory object is still there. Where? So what I'm doing here is get all the Active Directory computer properties, pipe them through to the next command, and I'm filtering them to a specific property, like this sign is anything that is being put through the pipe. So a for each statement, for example, where a property, and I made a few notes. Last logon date is lesser than. And this is the beauty of PowerShell version 3. You can make calculations on the spot, right there. So I'm doing a get date. Okay. So these are the devices that have been installed before today. So if I want to reverse it, don't know if it's newer then. Well, lesser than getDate. GetDate has a property, better a method, addMonths. But addMonths, you can add 12 months. No, no problem. But then I will find computers that haven't been created yet. So I won't find anything. The beauty of this is you can put in a negative value. And this way, I will find all the old computers. You can do just about the same with users. Instead of get AD computer, you will search AD account. You won't use a filter. You won't need to use a filter. As you can see, the rest of the syntax is exactly the same. Why not? What am I doing wrong here? Okay, this is the nightmare with demos. Something can go wrong, or I'm doing something wrong myself. Anyway, the basic idea is when the property for Active Directory is the same with 80 computers and 80 users and 80 anything, you can use it the same way. What space? No, and I can show you. Oh, clear screen. Get command. Where the noun, where the verb equals, what was it? Search. And they've made a little change in PowerShell version 3. Basically, the help. It isn't there anymore. Not exactly. Natively, PowerShell used to be installed with help files. Well, the problem with it was that the product was still developing and the help files not. Basically, the product comes out. For the product, they create updates, but help isn't considered worthy of an update. At least not a critical update or something. So that's why they don't update help files like that. So what you can do with a management server where I write my PowerShell scripts, I do get command, and for each get command, update help. I don't think this is going to work. Because it will probably require internet connection. But this is with a simple command, you can update all the help files. But the beauty, I've got my connection to my customer, and they haven't got PowerShell version 3 yet. So, I've got a bunch of commands. This isn't the domain controller, so search AD account isn't there yet. So get child item, for example. Well, let's make it practical. Let's get process. How does it work? Okay, right now I know that there's a command named get process. So get help. And I'm getting basic help. But I'm lazy. I don't ever use the read the entire help. It's way too much work. So what I do, I go straight to the examples. And this is a very quick way to look up syntax, examples, practical examples that are in there. But these are all examples for native PowerShell commands. Like the ones I did just now, finding the domain controllers. You won't find in there. That's a little bit more advanced. Like I said, when you do get process, you've got a bunch of processes. You got select property. Good morning. Select object, and I want to order properties. What it's doing now is getting all the properties for all the services. Sorry. So what if I want to get all the properties, but only one time? With get member, you get the properties, the property sets, the script properties, the methods, everything. So So you've got one list with all the information you require for that object. Let's see if I can think of an example. Yeah, get. Now you can't see anything. Here we go. It's empty. I need to find the location where there's a bunch of files. So, yeah, looks like my directory. With get child item, again, you can get some information. Some information about the object you're getting, in this situation, the files or and directories. So what I want to do now is, what can I do with those? I can get the access control, I can get the hash code, a bunch of stuff. But also, especially important, last access time. Good morning. So, what I want to see here is select last access time. Instead of selecting, I want to find the last the files that are last accessed, let's say more than a week ago. Is that possible? No, more than, what month is it, 7? More than 2 months ago. Is lesser than. Problem here, this won't work. The reason, they're not using PowerShell version 3 yet. I have to add something, add months minus 2. Oh, it is working. Good news, they've installed PowerShell version 3. I'm away 2 days, come on. So, what I use this for is this customer has a disk anything anyone can put stuff on. It's accessible to everyone, but it's also never cleaned. So they asked me to write a simple script, a one line in this case, to clean up those files. Everything that hasn't been touched for 6 months, delete. You can also report for home deer users. Let's say that you've got home deers without a quota. How do you know which one are the big users, the big consumers? Again, one PowerShell line and you've got them. Any questions so far? What? Yeah. It's basically get child item recursively and get the length of all those files, all those directories. Correction directory hasn't got a size, but all those files and add them to each other. It's a little bit bigger one liner, but it's still one line. And there is a way of cheating. Creating one-liners that are not exactly one-liners, but they still fit on one line. So, what's a one-liner? And that's with the simple point, comma. Get process will get all the processes. Get child item. Again, child item and get services. Get servers. We'll get all the services. So what if I get child item? Get process. I've got thick fingers. Yeah. Let's do it like this, else it won't fit on the screen. I made a typo. Good shot. What the? Yeah. Let's do it a little bit differently. You got the surfaces, so. No typo? No typo. So it's a little bit cheating. But it still works. And when you're doing scripting, one-liners can become very, very big. So when that happens, and I especially say when because it will, get process. What happens here is where blah 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 blah. With every pipe, you're allowed to go to the next line. Let's say that you're not piping. Basically, your line is very big without pipes in there. You can use a backtick. A backtick will tell you to go to the next line without using pipe. It's like basically continue here. And especially because I love one-liners, my lines get a little bit big. And Don Jones, the PowerShell MVP, told me about this one, the backtick. And suddenly I can read my scripts again. So I'm happy. Is this new to anyone? Now, there's still one thing I want to show you, and that is Virtual Machine Manager. Because my secondary focus is Microsoft Virtualization. And especially for reporting, when I get to customers, the one-liners are very powerful. For example, the utilization of the cluster shared volumes. Let's say they're for 90% in use, all of them. Then you can go to the GUI, no problem. You can see that in cluster, failover cluster manager, if I'm not mistaken. But what if you've got six clusters? Then you would have to go to a node for every cluster, look it up. But I'm lazy again, so I want to do it simple. And let me take a look. Well, some products will offer you in the start menu a very useful icon that will start PowerShell already loaded with the product module. DPM, for example, Exchange has one, Virtual Machine Manager. So, get Virtual Machine. Okay, it's saying it needs connection to the Virtual Machine Manager. Server. That's correct, because when I do this once, and this one will accept localhost. When I remove it now, it will work. So it will only need to lay the collection make the connection once, and it can use it throughout the entire session. When I close this PowerShell prompt, it's gone again. I have to re-establish the connection. And here goes the same. There's a lot of information, so I only want the name. Well, like I said, I've got the get virtual machine. Now I've got all the virtual machines. Now I want to get VM host. That's again a lot of information, so select only the name. And this way, on the fly, I can get a lot of information with the system administrator sitting next to me and like, ho, stop typing, because he can't follow. And that's always a nice reaction, and then you slow down and explain it to them. And the last one, a few were amazed within 10 minutes about what I could find out just by sitting in a prompt. That's it. And PowerShell remoting wasn't even enabled yet. I showed them what the PowerShell remoting was able to offer, and within a week they enabled it. It's about 3, maybe 4 group policy settings, done. Now I've prepared something, because this is one of the liners that is very sensitive to typos. Well, let's say for example here, I've got a I'm getting all the virtual machines, and I'm selecting the virtual DVD drives. And let me explain that a little bit. Why I'm doing it like I'm doing it. When I select the virtual DVD drives, I'm getting a bunch of information that's completely useless. It's the machine names. I know that already. Expand property. Virtual DVD drives. Now, why do I know I can use expand property? Very simple, it's between brackets, the output. That is saying you there's more behind me. And there is. So again, when I, clear screen. Within those properties I got back, there's the name and the ISO. And when I go up, I know that at least 2 virtual machines still have the IPv integration tools mapped. Let's say, for example, that you map an ISO file that's not part of your virtual machine manager environment, but basically sitting somewhere on a host. Then the virtual machine manager will tell you that's an unsupported cluster configuration. Because if the machine fails over, it won't have access anymore to the ISO file. And that was one of the many causes I found for that error. And with virtual machine manager, that error is very well known. For example, if you've migrated to your virtual networks to other names, sometimes it will automatically see the new name, sometimes it won't. So my experience is to migrate to the new name and use a PowerShell script or one-liner again, simply to migrate to switch those virtual machines to the different virtual network. And yep, get good morning, CLS, clear screen, get VM host, get VM host volume. What I'm now getting is a lot of information, basically the cluster shared volumes. As you can see, for example, here. It's volume 3 for this node, RTC EVM 001. And now I'm going to copy paste again. And I'll explain it. Like you can see, again, this is a one liner. It's a bit bigger, a little bit bigger. Yeah. What I'm doing here is I'm selecting custom properties. The properties I want aren't there yet, so I have to create them on the fly. And what I'm doing is I'm creating a custom property with the label named label, and the expression is the volume label. That's very regular. Next, I'm creating a secondary custom property, again with a label, but this time named percentage available. And as the expression, I'm doing a little bit of math. Like I'm calculating what space is available. So if I do this, as you can see, there are a bunch of volumes with a lot of the free space actually. As you can see, the e-disc, for example, is also taken with it. So all local volumes will be included. You can filter on it to only include the cluster set volume disks. And if you've got your naming correctly, like CSV volume 1, well, volume 3, for example, you can simply filter for the label, and it has to include CSV. And you're done. But that would mean that your customers would have to be consistent in their naming. And most of my environments are managed by a bunch of system administrators, and a lot of people together are never consistent, somehow. Okay. Do you ever need to create a bunch of demo users? Anyone? No one? Okay. What if you could do it easily? Like, do you use tools for that? Come on, my virtual machine isn't working along. Then we're doing it like this. Ooh. That's for in a few minutes. Do you use tools for that? Anyone? Like SCCM or Quest Software has a tool for that? Okay. You can do the same with PowerShell. Quest also has Quest CMD lids. Are also very powerful. There is an Active Directory CMD lid named new AD user. Again, I'm getting the help and the examples. The advantage here is with PowerShell version 3, with version 2, you had to load the Active Directory module before you could use those CMD lids. PowerShell version 3 has a list with all the CMD lids available on the system and the module they're part of. So it will automatically see new AD user is part of the Active Directory module, so I have to load it. You saw the little bar going by? That's it. And again, it's stating get help cannot find the help files. Like I said, help isn't included anymore. And this machine doesn't have access to internet. Only my host, not my virtual machine. So, what I'm going to do is wondering where my script has gone to. Ah, there you are. What I'm going to do here is make it a bit readable. Yeah. What I'm doing here is a for statement. Do any of you don't know what a for statement is? It's basically the same as with VB. What I'm saying here is the value I has to, starts with 1. It has to be lesser than 5 before it ends. And with every loop, it has to increase with 1. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 again. Well, I heard there are about 500 visitors at Briforum, so let's make 500 users. The name of the user will be Briforum, following by a number. they will be enabled. They will not have to change their password at logon. And here's the tricky part. The account password, Active Directory will demand you to put in the password securely. So PowerShell can do that. You can convert a string to a secure string. Well, Briform 01 is the password I've chosen. And this is a password that complies with complexity demands and stuff like that. It's sending it as plain text, and it will use a force. Force isn't necessary here, but in my experience, when I'm sure of something, I use a lot of the times I use force, because if I'm getting errors, it will ignore them and still do it. And the password will never expire. So, I'm going to my GUI to show you that there are no, the users don't exist yet. As you can see, it's very empty. And with one line, this may take I would say this would take a minute. Oh, it's good morning, Wouters. Well, anyway, here are the five users. I haven't enabled Active Directory Recycle Bin, so I'm deleting them. And let's make that into 500. Just to give you an idea how long it will take, and especially how powerful this is. I'm estimating that it will take about 25, maybe 30 seconds. And I've got 500 users created, demo users. This is something I've done for a Microsoft evangelist. He was very interested into PowerShell, but he made one tiny little mistake, especially tiny. Because the Briform $i, he didn't put quotes around them. And after that, he tried them with single quotes. And just so you can define a string by quotes and put the variable in there. And it will automatically calculate the variable and change it. That's like, do you know any other language that does that with the exception of Linux? So, for a scripter perspective, PowerShell, I think it's very user-friendly. Because it's all about looking at other languages and taking what's useful from those languages and using it in PowerShell. For example, are there any Linux fans in here? Next to me. No one? Okay, what the Linux guys mostly like. Again, I can use get help. It will give me help. Man, as in manual, is a Linux command. Those guys are happy again. They can still use man. And when you look at PowerShell itself, and you do get alias, you can see the aliases that are available to the CMDlets. For example, set PS breakpoint. It's a lot of typing. When SBP is a lot faster. The disadvantage of this is that your scripts will eventually become unreadable to anyone else. So there's something, yes, you have to watch out for, but on the fly, it works very fast. And let's go back to my Active Directory, because my users were created. And here we go, 500 users. How long did it take? 20? 30 seconds? How long will your tool take to create them? Or your intern? back when I was an intern, I would have loved to have this. I was doing it through a VB script, and it took me about two days to make the script. So actually clicking was about maybe 3 hours work. So, and the beauty of this, this is entirely documented. Examples and everything. Copy, paste, fill in, you're done. Is there anything you want to see in an Active Directory environment? Okay. A friend of mine contacted me because they did an exchange migration. They migrated the users and the entire environment to a new domain. Well, all right, you've got your Active Directory, all your users are created, and then you install an Exchange server. So basically, you want to mail enable all those customers. That's possible. Here we are. It's a don't look at the picture. Again, this. It's a simple PowerShell one-liner. You're getting all the contacts and you're mail-enabling them. That's it. This, in his case, took a little bit longer. It was 18,000 users. That's cool. But simply one command, and this took me about maybe an hour, one and a half to figure out. And mostly because I didn't have such an environment, so I had to send him the code. He tested it, provided me feedback, etc. So if you're, I wouldn't say fluent, but if you're experienced with PowerShell, this is stuff you can do within an hour. Wouldn't you like that? And again, I'm crazy about one-liners. So basically, jeffwouters.nl is my blog. Currently, the Dutch PowerShell user group also has a website, and the five of us have linked our blog posts to them. So everything we will blog personally is also on that website.